This video will cover getting the airplane prepared for flight, and specifically these topics. One difference between starting the CJ4 and the Longitude is the Longitude uses bleed air to rotate a starter instead of electricity to crank a starter motor like the CJ4. Both batteries need to be turned on. I like to bring up the electrical page to get to that. You go to Aircraft Systems, Synoptics, and then Electrical. You can see the electrical page there. And then after that, go straight down and start the APU, which is located on the back of the center pedestal. To start the APU, simply go over to the start position. Looking back at the MFD, the APU start needs to be monitored, and that can be done by watching right here. The APU RPM will go to 100%, and when the start is complete, the APU generator can be turned on, but if it's not turned on, a CAS message will appear up here. Another indication the generator is not on, the load will be at 0%. As mentioned earlier, the batteries are powering the whole airplane right now, but when that APU generator comes on, this relay right here will close and connect the line from the APU generator to the left emergency bus. The electrical system is also split, left side and right side. The one thing that will bring them together is the bus tie. Right now that bus tie is open. But watch what happens when the APU generator is placed online. Right there, that relay closes, the bus tie closes automatically. The APU generator is now powering the whole electrical system. The start pressure is currently zero. The APU is running. That system is on a timer. After a certain amount of time, 32 PSI will appear. Prior to engine start with the APU running would be the ideal time to program the Garmin 5000. Since we're on the subject of starting engines, we're going to go ahead and continue with starting both engines and then program the Garmin 5000 for takeoff, including how to compute V-speeds and takeoff distance. To start the engine, verify a minimum of 32 PSI in the start box, then lift the guard, press the run stop button so run illuminates, followed by pressing the start button. Pressing the starter button will automatically engage the start sequence and will automatically disengage upon completion of the engine start sequence. ITT needs to be monitored during the start. Even though the gauge reads zero, we do have fuel flow because we have a rising ITT. As the engine starts, you can see the start message next to the N1 display. The message by the N1 display goes away, and also the light extinguishes on the starter button at the end of the start cycle. The left and right generators are normally turned on prior to engine start. Watch this relay close as the left generator is turned on. But with both generators turned on in a normal situation, that will happen automatically. The same steps will be taken to start the other engine. Starting the opposite engine, the process is identical, so we're going to skip over that and move straight into programming the FMS. On this flight, we're going to go from Aspen, Colorado over to BJC, which is on the northwest side of Denver. First step is go into flight plan, and instead of typing Aspen, we can go to add origin and click the find button. It'll find the nearest airports and just click Aspen, so we don't have to type it in, and then add the destination KBJC. From the same screen, go to procedure, and we're going to select the departure. We're going to select the lens 9 departure and the red table transition, followed by selecting load. The waypoints on the departure can now be checked against the waypoints on the chart if so desired. Once that's done, go back one page and go to performance. Under performance, select weight and fuel. And this is where we're going to start to get takeoff performance numbers. This part of the process is sped up. Just go to each section, enter the weight that you have set up for the flight, enter the number of passengers, and then when finished, the fuel quantity can be entered in gallons or pounds if the settings are changed. Mine's in gallons. The easy way is to press FOB or fuel on board sync, and the quantity of fuel currently on board the aircraft will automatically be entered, as you just saw there on the screen. Pressing FOB or fuel on board sync is the easiest way. And this page will be left blank because we're only dealing with takeoff. Next, select takeoff data. And here, just fill in the blanks. We are departing Aspen. We are departing runway 33. We can look at the weather. We can show the METAR and we can actually read it. Winds are 210 at 3, 10 miles and clear. Temperatures minus 11, altimeters 3027. And we can input it manually or load METAR wind. 201 at 3, slightly different but still close. Pressing use RAT or ram air temperature will automatically insert the temperature. Selecting runway on the left shows us the takeoff run available, the elevation of the airport, the runway heading, and also the gradient is 2% down. All that information was entered automatically from the database. Next, we go to takeoff configuration. We can adjust takeoff flaps, turn anti-ice on or off, and select or change any other factors that we may have for a particular takeoff. Moving on down to the takeoff data selection, this page gives all the V-speeds as well as takeoff distance available and takeoff distance required. We have a two-knot tailwind component, a left crosswind, and also the takeoff weight. If everything looks good, you can hit accept takeoff speeds. If you decide to do a rolling takeoff, you can, but that will add about 500 feet to your takeoff distance. Departing from a mountainous airport, we do not want to do a rolling takeoff. So all the speeds look good, we'll accept takeoff speeds, and then check flaps is illuminated just below accept takeoff speeds. That's because we had selected flaps 1, they were up, now they're at flaps 1, the message went out. If you'd like to verify the speeds, go back a page, select speed bugs, and there's all the V speeds that we just calculated, and they are all automatically selected. The airplane's mostly ready for takeoff, but there's two more very important things we need to cover. And one of those two items is the takeoff warning system. A lot of times on takeoff, you add power, and you'll see that no takeoff warning there on the left. And a few different items will trigger that warning. One is any of the trims. As we can see, the elevator trim out of the green arc, it's now in the green arc. The flaps are not set. And here when flaps 1 are selected, the message goes away. Also because the parking brake is off. If the parking brake was set, that message would still appear, regardless of the trims being in the green or the flaps being set correctly. And you'll also see the CAS 0 with the up arrow and the 0 with the down arrow. Here's what that means. Here I've done everything I possibly could to the airplane to get as many CAS messages as possible. Now you can see CAS 0 up and 4 with a down arrow. All that means, there's 4 more messages down below the bottom of the screen that we can't see. To see those, go over to the left touch controller. Simply select scroll CAS up or down to navigate through the CAS messages. This last item will give the engine more power, sometimes. This system is automatic power reserve. If an engine quits, it gives the operating engine a boost of power. The system is normally on by lifting that guard and pressing off. You can turn that system off manually. And here's a demonstration of what it will do. Say we go to takeoff power, we're in a climb, an engine rolls back automatically, that will kick in that power reserve, allowing the operating engine to produce slightly more thrust in situations when the engine normally would not create max rated thrust, such as high altitudes and high temperatures. And instead of the TO message you see there on the N1, that will actually change to APR and turn green. As the system is turned on manually and full power is applied, APR is now displayed. Other than running checklists, the airplane's pretty much ready for takeoff. If you want to learn more about this airplane, there is a link in the description for a manual to this airplane, specifically for Microsoft Flight Simulator. That manual has systems, there's checklists, there's a lot of information in that manual. There's actually 139 pages in that manual. But if you would like a manual with less pages, I have also made a mini guide for the TBM-930 with important speeds, performance figures, and personally made a checklist covering before engine start all the way to the shutdown. And there's also the same type of checklist for the CJ4. Both are tailored to Microsoft Flight Simulator and available to channel members by clicking on the link in the community section of the channel. That's all for now. Thank you for watching.